Okay, so hi everyone. So today I would like to give you a short overview or presentation about how we can use dynamical cost approximation as a way to go beyond dynamical mean field theory in order to study Mott and Anderson localizations. Before I go on, I would like to acknowledge NSF for funding our research through this collaboration and other individual funds. Oops. Okay, here we go. So let me give you a little bit of roadmap, what we have discussed in the series of lectures so far. So far we have had several lectures on so-called effective medium methods or embedding methods for strongly disordered and strongly interacting systems. So we have lecture on dynamical mean field theory, which is a very powerful single site approximation for treating a strong electron-electron interaction. This is a link to the YouTube lecture. We have also a lecture on CPA, which is analog to DMFT, but for disordered system. And 2 weeks ago, Vlad gave us a talk on a typical medium theory, which is a embedding theory for treating electron localization in strongly disordered materials. And this is linked to his lecture. So all these lectures are available on Mott Lectures channel, so please check them out. Some people are emailing me with questions, so if you have questions, please don't hesitate to ask us. And the focus of today's presentation will be to go beyond single-site approximation, and in particular, and there are many ways to go beyond single-site approximation or beyond DMFT, but today we will focus on one of the ways how we can do this, in particular using dynamical cluster approximation or DCA as a way to go beyond single-site approximation for strongly interacting and typical medium version of DCA for strongly disordered materials. And I will show you application of DCA and TMDCA in metal insulated transition study. So dynamical cluster approximation has been developed by Mark Jarrell and his collaborators. And I think this week is actually 2 years since Mark passed away. DCA, a dynamical cluster approximation, has proven to be a very powerful tool beyond DMFT, which is now used widely in various areas of research, including strongly correlated electron system, disordered system, phonon localization, as well as its application in real materials ab initio DFT study. One can use dynamical cluster approximation to study a variety of physical phenomena and interesting questions that arise in quantum materials, including superconductivity, quantum critical, Fermi liquid, quantum magnetism, metal insulated transition. Recently, it has been implemented to study two particle properties, RICS, NMR, Lifshitz transition, also non-equilibrium physics, and phonon and electron localization. Today, I will focus on metal insulated transition and electron localization in strongly correlated and also disordered system. So the properties of real materials are strongly affected by Coulomb electron-electron interactions and disorder, and electron-electron interaction and disorder are consequently two mechanisms to drive the metal insulated transition. If the metal insulated transition is driven by electron-electron interaction, we call it Mott-Hubbard transition, and this is relevant to a wide range of materials in periodic system. These are so-called transition metal oxides, systems with partially filled d and f orbitals, where having two electrons on a given side cause energy U, which leads to the opening of the gap in the density of state. So classical examples of Mott metal insulated transitions that have been studied for a while, it's nickel oxide and vanadium oxide. Okay, so in these materials, Mott metal insulated transition is characterized by the opening of the Mott gap in the density of state of the value of U. So an increasing interaction strength over bandwidth ratio, one can drive the system from metal to correlated metal with characteristic three-peak structure and to the Mott insulator when the gap is open. Disorder is another mechanism of driving metal insulated transition or localization or a way to localize electrons. And in disorder is inevitably present in real materials. So now electrons, instead of moving in a periodic crystal, they move in this randomly distributed, randomly distributed crystal, disorder potential. Okay. And for disordered system, we introduce the concept of extended and localized states. So when we have a small disorder, the periodic wave function of electrons is modified slightly like this, but it still is an extended state. So if you calculate the phi squared or probability of finding electron in a system, you will find that there is a finite probability to find electron in any part of the system. So they are extended over the whole sample. However, as you increase disorder, at some point, you will drive the system into the localized state, and this is characterized by having this envelope-like structure of the wave function, where you have a region of zero probability to find electrons, and electrons are basically spatially localized within some localization length psi. It's interesting to note that unlike metal insulated transition, where we use our a standard solid state knowledge about this knowledge how to distinguish metal from insulator, for Anderson insulator there is no gap opening in the spectrum. Okay, so instead we have in the spectrum energy which we call mobility edge, which separates localized from extended states. So if so we are talking about now for disordered system, we are talking not about the gap but about the mobility edge. So if mobility edge, I denoted here by EC, is smaller than Fermi energy, like shown here. So we have up to this region, we have localized states. So once you introduce disorder, states in the band tails become to localize first. And this is intuitive understanding is that this would correspond to having states, this bound state in this deep potential, like trapping of electrons. But states above the mobility edge, shown here by this blue shading region, are extended. Okay, so they extended. However, as you increase disorder, at some point you will have this mobility edge on one side and another side meet together at the Fermi energy, and you will have the all states are localized. So this is the signal of Anderson localization or Anderson transition. Okay. Oops, it's not moving. Okay, why are we interested in this electron localization and metal insulated transition? Well, because this is one of the central phenomena in solid state physics, intense matter physics, and also because many functional properties of quantum materials are found near the metal insulated transition. This includes like system like high temperature superconductors, like that are heavily studied in strongly correlated community, where the parent compound is an antiferromagnetic Mott metal insulator, as you dope the system, Mott insulator can be destroyed and superconductivity emerges in some doping, and then metal emerges at larger doping and higher temperatures. Also, Anderson insulator is a key phenomenon which has been found in different semiconductors, right? We can have electron localized on impurity bands, and this can be used to manipulate conducting and photovoltaic properties of semiconducting materials. What is also interesting to notice that in vicinity of this metal insulated transition, various exotic states of matter emerge, like superconductivity, like shown here, charge order, inhomogeneities. One can have dramatic changes through in conducting properties of the materials through the transition. Also different type of order in magnetic, for example, orbital can emerge. And these exotic states, unlike simple metals or simple insulators, are very sensitive to external perturbations like temperature, doping, or pressure. So one can use this external perturbation to manipulate the properties of material in a more rational way. So for that reason, understanding electron localization and other phases near the localized states is interested both from fundamental research point of view, but also from the perspective of application. Excuse me, let me drink some water. The main motive of our numerical work. Okay, excuse me. So in general, these metal insulated transitions, they occur either for strong interaction or for strong disorder. So this is non-perturbative phenomena. So in which means that it cannot be solved analytically, and when it's solved analytically, you have analytical solutions only in limited cases, not all, on a whole parameter range. Excuse me. Therefore, studying metal insulated transition as a non-perturbative problem requires numerical method and self-consistent approximation. And it actually goes back to Phil Anderson's famous quote when he wrote localization, very few believe in that time, and even fewer saw its importance among those who failed with certain leads or there. And he said that localization had yet to receive adequate mathematical treatment, and one has to resort to the indignity of numerical simulation to settle even the simple questions about it. Okay, so let me now focus on part one. How can we use these numerical methods, self-consistent approximation in particular, to study MOD localization, and how it is important to and I will show you the importance of local and non-local description of this phenomenon. In order to study MOD metal insulated transition, the simplest model is, of course, Haber model. So it's given by this Hamiltonian, where in first term is a kinetic energy term, which describes the hopping of electrons between different sites I and J, nearest neighbor sites. And in Haber model, we use this approximation that electron-electron interactions are fully screened. So electron interactions are local. So electron only interact when they meet at a given site I, and because of the Pauli principle, they should have different spin orientation. Okay, so this is a minimal model that has been extensively used to study MOD metal insulated transition, because in this model, this term tends to delocalize electrons, like wants them to be extended states, while U terms doesn't like electron to come to jump from one side to another, because it's cost energy U to have two electrons at a given side. So electrons like to localize electrons. So there is intrinsic competition between this dual nature of electrons, extended and localized nature of electrons, right? But at the same time, the transition here happens at the, there is a challenge here, because the transition happens and when kinetic energy and potential energy are of the same order of magnitude. So it's a non-perturbative problem. Okay, for more details on Haber model, we have like two lectures, wonderful lectures by Kamin Tam, and they're available on Master YouTube. From the basic Haber model is derivation to some analytical solution. Please take a look at these lectures if you want to learn more about Haber model. Now, how do we solve Haber model using this effective medium approaches? A big breakthrough in our understanding of MOD transition as well as high temperature superconductors actually started with the development of dynamical mean field theory and its extension later on, okay? So dynamical mean field theory is a quantum impurity embedding approach. So what does it mean? So we have a lattice problem which we cannot solve, and we map this problem into impurity embedded in effective medium. And this effective medium contains this information of electron in the other parts of the lattice interacting with each other, and we call it like effective bath. Okay. What we are interested in finding in order to describe the system, we need to find Green's function, which is given by this Dyson equation, G0 plus G0 sigma G. So G0 is the Green's function of non-interacting system, right? So it's basically defined by the type of lattice you have. But the most important part is hidden in self-energy, because self-energy is a measure of correlation, effect, and different interactions that are present in the system. So our goal is to find self-energy. Finding this, we can have Green's function, and from that we can calculate spectrum function and whatever we want to do in order to compare with experiment. Okay, so however, in dynamical mean field theory approximation, because this is single site approximation, it neglects any k dependence of self energy. So k dependent in momentum space, which would correspond to r or in real space, right? Location in a real space. What does it mean? It means that dynamical mean field theory assumes that self energy at each point of the lattice is exactly the same. It's not function of the lattice coordinates of momentum. It's just a function of frequency omega. So it's mean field type of approximation, right? Because we kind of average out the rest and include only impurity, or it's not disordered impurity, just like a cavity. It's called dynamical mean field theory because it's not just a static number like we are used to Bragg-Williams mean field theory, right? It's not just effective field, it's a function of frequency which corresponds to fraction, a function in time. In other words, in DMFT, we can sample the dynamics at a given site, and this is shown here. This shows that DMFT allows the dynamics at a given site. So it shows here a function of time. So at impurity, we can have no states. We can have one electron coming from bath to the impurity with like spin up, then that can go away. Then another can come to the impurity and have a spin down, or we can have two interacting electrons in a given site. And this is where we will measure this U interaction between electrons, okay? So to summarize, DMFT is a mean field approximation for quantum Mendy system on a lattice. It maps the lattice model problem into the impurity embedded in self-consistently determined effective field. It ignores spatial fluctuation by construction because it's a single site approximation, but allows for quantum temporal or dynamic fluctuation. And DMFT has been shown it's exact in the infinite dimension link. So how do we solve this problem numerically in practice? Because we are computational physicists. So what we do this self-consistency loop. So one of the big points here is to solve the impurity problem where you can have this type of dynamic on a lattice. So what we do, we start with the local lattice Green's function, which is defined this way, and G bar corresponds to lattice cosgrain Green's function, by cosgrain means sum over momenta k, and it's one over omega minus epsilon k minus sigma. So you start with some guess of self energy, let's say it's going to be zero. You calculate G bar, then you calculate this effective medium Green's function, which enters as an impurity at the impurity level. Once you have this, you go to the impurity probe and you use Dyson equation, sorry. And once you have that, you solve the impurity problem where you can also sample the interaction between electron on this side zero, or this impurity side. Once this impurity problem, you can use like quantum Monte Carlo, hexagonalization, or whatever method you have available to solve the impurity problem. Once it is solved, it spills out the impurity Green's function, right? The Green's function at this impurity. Then you use Dyson equation to extract the update of self energy. So it's not going to be non-zero this time. And you use this self energy to plug it in back into the lattice local Green's function. And you do it self-consistently until you reach a self-consistency condition, which says that local lattice Green's function, this quantity, and the impurity Green's function are the same, okay? In a KKR, you have similar condition. You just have tau at coarse grain tau is equal to tau impurity. So a solution of Haber model using DMFT. We had this in our lecture a couple months ago, right? But I just, for the completeness of the presentation, I would like to mention that one of the biggest success of DMFT was that it was able to show the Mott metal insulated transition as we change U properly, right? To show it properly. So you start with the metal at small U, with no gap in the density of states. And as you increase interaction strength, you will have this three peak structure is emerging. And this peak corresponds to the quasi-particle peak. And as you increase interaction strength further, the quasi-particle peak shrinks because there is a transfer of weight transfer from the central peak to the Haber lower and Haber upper bands. When this quasi-particle peak vanishes, this is a you have a gap in the density of states, so you have a transition to the Mott insulator. This is lower band, this is upper Haber band, and this one called correlated a metal with characteristic three-peak structure. And that was a huge success of DMFT, that it was able to capture the three-peak structure and properly describe the gap in the density of states. Because it was able to confirm numerically what has been seen experimentally, the photoemission spectra, the transfer of weight from bands, central peak to the sub-Hubbard sub-bands, and as well the three-peak structure that has been seen experimentally as well. So more details on DMFT. We have a whole lecture, 1 hour lecture on this. So you can look, you can watch this lecture again to see some derivation of DMFT and its application, further application. But I would like to summarize here at this point that what DMFT can do and what DMFT cannot do. So DMFT incorporates strong interaction physics, so we can really sample the due interaction between electrons. It has been extended to multi-band or multi-orbital systems, so it can cover a multi-orbital effect, and it has been applied to real material to capture strong correlations effect. However, DMFT by construction, because this is just single site approximation, it neglects non-local correlation in any short range order. It can have some spurious phase transition in low dimensions. For example, in 1D, it has been shown that DMFT gives a spurious metal insulated transition while the right solution is that there is no metal insulated transition in 1D, a gap opens at any values of U. And DMFT cannot study the type of transition for which the order parameter is like non-local complex value. For example, if you want to study superconductivity with DMFT, you cannot study like D-Wave superconductivity because it doesn't allow for that. In today's lecture, I will present you the results which address these issues of DMFT, that it doesn't capture non-local correlations and its application in low-dimensional system. And in particular, I will show you our recent results on MOT-MET insulated transition in 2D Hubbard model. So there are two ways of going beyond DMFT, roughly speaking, right? So one can do a cluster extension of DMFT. So instead of solving impurity, you consider cluster embedded in effective medium, or one can do a diagrammatic extension or diagrammatic perturbation around DMFT. So this includes approximation like this D gamma A, one particle irreducible approximation, Trilex, dual Feldman approach that we actually did in LSU with Mark, which is perturbation around DMFT. As there could be DMFT plus GW, which is used extensively, real materials, and et cetera, okay? So both ways have their advantages and disadvantages. So for cluster extension, because you're still limited with the cluster size, so one treats short range correlations are treated properly, but long range correlations are neglected, because short range correlations are included in the cluster size, but the rest is treated in the mean field level. Cluster extension are controllable approximation in the sense that as you increase the cluster size, it becomes exact in the infinite dimension limit in the infinite cluster size. So in principle, they are controllable approximation. In practice, one very often is stuck with smaller or smallest cluster sizes, but that's what we can do at this moment, state of the art. For diagrammatic extension, advantages is that it can treat both short range and non-local correlations are considered. So, but it's a perturbation expansion. So one needs to truncate the diagrammatic series. And then the question is at which level, second order, ladder approximation, or which order one needs to stop. There have been numerous studies of Hubbard model with this method. And there are some literature, mentioned here. Our focus today is to consider cluster extension of DMFT. And I'll just highlight very simple facts about the cluster DMFT versions. So there are two types of cluster extension of dynamical mean field series, CDMFT and DCA. So the biggest difference between them is that CDMFT is a real space cluster method. So lattice is divided into clusters or supercells, and then one takes like this 2x2 cluster, embeds it in affecting medium, and this is and solves this numerically, self-consistently. So here we consider cluster in real space. Ij are the real space indices. It breaks translational symmetry. And if one wants to study like some momentum dependence of self-energy or spectral function, one needs to do some periodization in order to recover the translational symmetry. But this is done as a post-processing process. And it's a metric solution in the self-consistency loop. So very often CDMFT calculation for Hubbard model or superconductivity very often can be limited to the smaller cluster sizes. So larger clusters have been done in some parameter regime. On the other hand, DCA or dynamical cluster approximation is a cluster constructed in momentum space. Okay, so the reciprocal space of the lattice, like shown here, with endpoints of these gray points is endpoints of the lattice, is divided into NC cells. So here we have NC is equal to 4. The number of clusters is equal to 4, or number of K momenta will be equal to 4 here. And each cell is centered around the cluster K. So which means that, let's consider this cluster, right? Which means that in this cluster, you have this many, many points. They will be defined by this little K, lattice cluster momenta. But DCA says, okay, let's average this out, and we call it coarse graining, basically summation over K tilde. And we only focus and say that all these points within these clusters are described by this capital K, right? So we do the mapping from many K to K mapping, from little k, lattice K, to a capital K mapping. This is called causal graining, and it's done just by basically by averaging or addition over the K tilde. So in DCA, we calculate coarse grain, Green's function as self energy, G bar, and this is nothing else, just summation over K tilde. And our quantities are now momentum dependent. So DCA is a periodic cluster, right, in the affecting medium. Since this is periodic, so you need to have like, you do one n is the same as n1. So you have a torus in momentum space. It's translationally invariant, so symmetry is not broken. It converges as 1 over L to the power of G. L is the linear size of the cluster. And because self-consistency equations, these K momenta equations are, this matrix is diagonal. So you still are left with scalar solution in the self-consistency loop. So it's easy to solve. But both these clusters have two limits. When NC equal to 1, a cluster is equal to 1, we recover DMFT. And when NC goes to infinity, we recover the exact solution. Both of them include short range correlation within the cluster, like here. The challenge is that one needs to have efficient cluster solvers, especially if you go away from half filling, one would have a sign problem, which can be quite severe and limits calculations, limits our ability to calculate interesting regimes there. Okay, now how it is implemented numerical in self-consistency loop. Philosophy is very simple. This is DMFT self-consistency loop. You see nothing is changed except I'm adding K dependence to K capital cluster momenta cluster dependence into Green's function self energy and effective medium Green's function. Okay, so everything is becomes momentum capital dependent, K capital momentum dependent, and instead of solving impurity solver problem, one has to solve a cluster problem. Okay, and now let me show you some results that these are new results which have been posted recently on Archive. And in particular, we are using dynamical cluster approximation, the smallest cluster NC equal to 4, to solve Hubbard model in two dimensions. And we are looking at the mod metal insulated transition or in U-driven metal insulated transition. So how do we look at this? How do we study this? As I mentioned earlier, self-energy is the quantity which can measure the correlations effect. So in order to see the transition from metal to insulator, we plot self-energy energy, and here we plotted pi zero, because for 2 by 2 clusters, the last point to localize. And we plotted for different, at fixed temperature, let's say this temperature, okay? And we plotted at different values of U. So for small U, self energy will be small and will be, imaginary part of self energy will be small and will be directed toward to zero. This is an indication, this is metal. And as you increase the interaction strength, self energy increases. And at some point it's gonna to be pointed in this to infinity, right? This will signal the appearance of poles in the imaginary axis. So we have metal to insulated transition as we change U. Notice that here we have for U equal 4.0, these are blue crosses, open closed symbols and open symbols. So metal, mod metal insulated transition is a first order transition. So it really depends from which solution you start. If you start from the metallic solution, you will go like from this black curve to this curve, then to red and so on. So you will recover this solution if you start from metal. But if you start from insulating solution, you start from here, the solution at U equal 4.0 will be this self energy. Okay, so you will find insulated at this value of U. This indicates there is a first order transition and there is a coexisting region at some parameters, in particular here for values of U equal to 4, you can have metallic or insulating solution. Okay, and one can perform this analysis for this U scan analysis for different temperatures and construct the phase diagram. And I want to point out how we construct the phase diagram. So we look at the self energy behavior. In particular, we look at the delta sigma. This is one of the common ways to identify metal insulated transition in strongly correlated community. And we just look if these lowest 2 points are tilted towards zero or they are pointing towards infinity. So if delta sigma zero is smaller than sigma is smaller than zero, you take 2 lowest Matsubara point and you find delta sigma. If this is point less than zero, so you are pointing this way. And if they are larger than zero, this means you have this kind of situation. So this is insulated. So by changing the, by looking at the change of the delta sigma from zero, so negative to positive, we can identify the transition because that will correspond to this flat behavior here. Transition or crossover, depending where you are located. And this is exactly what we have done. So we have done this analysis of delta, imaginary part of sigma at pi zero at lowest 2 Matsubara points for different temperatures, low temperature. And so temperature is increased if you go this way. And here we plot delta M self energy difference at the lowest 2 Matsubara points as function of U. So we go from negative value here, then we see at lowest temperature, let's see 0.01, we see a huge jump in a jump, and we go to the positive value of delta sigma. This indicates there is a metal to insulate a first order transition in this direction. To confirm that this is first order, now we have to go start from insulating solution and now decrease self energy U, and we should again have a jump to go back to metallic solution. So this corresponds to the points 0.01, these points here. So if you go from left to right, we will have closed simple circle. This is when metallic solution stops. This is this point and you get to insulator. And open symbol here corresponds if you go from the right, from insulating solution, and insulator solution exists up to this point. And then it becomes a metal, which corresponds to this behavior here. So one can do the scans for different temperatures, right? And this is what is done here. As we increase the temperature, we see that coexisting region, as expected, it's going to shrink and become smaller and smaller, which is shown here at this temperature. And this corresponds to these points here. And at some higher temperatures, there is no jump in the behavior. This means that we are already above the TC or critical point TC, and we have a continuous phase transition or crossover from metal to insulator, which represents these points here. So here we have a continuous change from metallic to insulating behavior, this dashed line point here. And below this TC point here, we have a jumps in the behavior, which is indication of the first order transition. But my point here as a focus is the following. Let me point out the important thing here. So if here we plot temperature as function of U, phase diagram, right? So change in interaction, and we plot here for data, show data here for our GCA 2x2 cluster. We also use the data from the literature done by André-Marie Tremblay and also from Gabi Kotler's and Christian Howell group earlier data 2008. So we plot the data for CDMFT, real space cluster calculation. And here our data for dynamical mean field theory for NC equal to one. Okay. So what do we see? As we change the transition, as we change U at given temperature, the system goes from a metal where density of states will look like this to an insulator where you will have a gap in the density of states. Closer to transition, like this point here, or this point here, or this point here, you will see this characteristic three peak structure, okay? And passing this point, this peak will disappear, okay? This is the first order transition, so it depends where you are moving, which trajectory you're going from metal to insulator, from insulator to metal. And so that's why we have the spinodal lines, UC1 and UC2. So these spinodal lines signal the boundaries, like UC2 signals the boundary or at which metallic solution exists up to here and then disappears. And this UC1 spinodal line points the boundary at which insulator exists. You start from here, insulator exists up to here, and then metallic behavior for DMFT. Okay, but what do you need to notice from this phase diagram? First of all, we see is that going beyond DMFT in 2D is really important, right? Using cluster approximation is really important because we see that cluster non-local correlation or non-local effects are significant, right? We see the phase diagram is pushing out the lower values of U and also lower values of temperature at which we can have metal insulated transition. Also, we still, for this small cluster, we still observe that the metal insulated transition is still first order transition, like in NC equal to one. And also we can see that the shape of the phase transition changes. We have here negative slope, and for cluster extension, we now have positive slope. Okay, so main message here to describe Mott Haber metal insulated transition in lower dimension, in particular 2D, one indeed has to go beyond DMFT because non-local correlations and fluctuations are important. Now, let me show you some more results. So, in order to demonstrate this. This correlation-driven effect, one can also look at the quasi-particle peak, which is inversely proportional to the effective mass as function of U. Okay, so if as increase in U, we can see quasi-particle peak goes to zero or decreases. This indicates that as you increase U and you go to the more insulated regime, effective mass will increase. Right, particle will behave like very heavy or correlated particles. So this is indication that this is really strong correlations effect. And also one can look at the double occupancy, right, at a given site. So here the double occupancy is shown as function of U for different temperatures, the same temperature parameter as before. We again see the jumps in the double occupancy. Let's look at this red curve. You increase U, double occupancy decreases, and then it's suppressed at larger values of U. So that will correspond to this picture that once you have large U, you don't want to have, it's energetically expensive to have two electrons in a given site, right? So electron will try to stay as away from each other as much as possible and don't hop from one side to another. So you will have like singly occupied sites instead of doubly occupied site. So this is another indication, this is interaction or correlation driven phase transition. There has been a lot of attention recently. There has been a lot of attention to this metal insulated transition in two dimension. And it started with like 2015, there was a paper about fate of Mott metal insulated transition in 2D. But it has been shown that if you use like D gamma A, one of the approximation which can go beyond DMFT, it has been shown that if you use this non-local approximation, the metal insulated transition At zero temperature, you will not have metal insulated transition. You will always have a gap in the spectrum, but we can also see at finite temperatures, the metal insulated transition is pushed to very much smaller values of U. So within the cluster approximations, there still remains to show, and we are working on this currently, so stay tuned. But bottom line here is that at this part of the presentation, I have shown you that for mode localization, or interaction-driven metal insulated transition in two dimension, it's really, really important to go beyond the MFT local picture, because the local correlation effects are strong for these systems. Okay, now let me go to part two. So in this lecture, I want to show two examples, like how can we use dynamical cluster approximation to study two examples of localization. So before we look at more transition, now let's focus on Anderson transition. And why non-local interaction and going beyond single psi approximation is also important for description of Anderson localization. So intuitive picture about this, why do we need to go beyond single psi approximation is shown in this picture. So one of the ways to localize electrons, is a kind of obvious way to localize electron, is to have them trapped or localized in some of this deep local potential, right? So they cannot escape from there. But another mechanism to localize, in addition to this, another mechanism to localize electrons was pointed out actually by Phil Anderson, and it comes from this multi-scattering of electrons. So these points here represent different impurities in your system. Like an electron can, for example, start at point one and get scattered to impurity two, then three, then four, and so on. Can go like this counterclockwise path. But electron is a wave, so there is equally probable clockwise path of scattering of electrons. And due to the quantum nature of this phenomenon, right, one can have time reverse paths interfere. So you can have a constructive interference of forward and backwards going scattering way, which can lead to this localization of electron in this kind of going around the loop. Okay, so again, Anderson pointed out that coherent backscattering, which arises from multiple scattering of impurities, can lead to this constructive interference of forward and backward scattering, right? And we can have localization of electron within this space, basically going around the loop. Okay, so in this lecture, we are focusing only on effective medium approaches, right? So for the completeness of the presentation, though we did have lecture on CPA and TMT, I would give a very short review of it. So, but before that, how do we study Anderson insulator? We again choose the simplest model we can do. We can choose, right? And this is Anderson model, which is described by this Hopping term, kinetic energy term. We consider non-interacting electrons at this point, and we model disorder by this random potential V. So this V is a random potential on the lattice, which is basically, this is a picture, a rough picture of what it represents. So you have random boxes, random potential wells in your in your sample, right? And the distribution of this randomness of the depth of this wells can be is like is in the range, like, for example, can be modeled to be in the range from minus W to, it should be plus W. This is what we call box distribution of random disorder. Or you can say that another way to model disorder is like alloy system, where you can say, okay, I started with some system with A atoms, and then randomly you introduce B atom into the system with certain concentration or certain probability. Okay, so these are two commonly used way to model disorder in materials, but there are much more, more of course, ways to do that. So let's quickly review a coherent potential approximation. So coherent potential approximation on CPA, it has been discovered quite a while ago, much earlier than DMFT in 1967 or 70s, right? So the but the philosophy is very much the same. So you start with your original disorder lattice system, where you have random potential at different sites Vi, and you map this lattice into the effective medium lattice, which is described by this effective potential sigma omega. And you see sigma omega is this effective potential, right, instead of V. It's not K or psi dependent. So we assume that this is exactly the same at each point of the lattice. But now we need to find out what is the sigma omega. So to do this, we need to determine the self consistently. So we place a real impurity. So for CPA, it's a real disorder plays in this effective impurity. So if you have a disorder, you have to do disorder averaging, which is shown by these brackets. And self-consistency condition requires that disorder average Green's function of this impurity plays in this effective medium is equal to the Green's function, local Green's function of this effective medium sigma omega, shown here. So again, as like in DMFT, CPA is a local approximation, so it neglects K-dependent or spatial-dependent of the potential or self-energy in the lattice, but it is a function of frequency. So it's not static mean field, it's again a dynamical mean field approximation, okay? So it can take into account the dynamics at a given site. And it has been found a long time ago that it's a good approximation to describe, for example, density of states of your disordered system, but it fails to describe Anderson localization. And CPA is actually exact in infinite dimension limit. This has been shown by Dieter Vorhan and Lemmings. Okay, but as we can see, by construction, it's very similar to dynamical mean field theory. They both make the same approximation, the self-energy is constant, and they both employ the same procedure, map the lattice into the quantum impurity problem, embedding some infective field, which has to be solved self-consistently. And just to show you that this is really very, very similar, this is CPA self-consistency loop, and this is a DMFT self-consistency loop, right? So if you look at the equations, they're exactly the same. The only difference is the type of the impurity problem you're solving. For CPA, you're solving impurity with V, with disorder, and for DMFT, you're solving impurity with interaction mu. Okay, that's all what is the difference. Of course, this one is much more difficult to calculate because it's interacting system. This is easier to do. Okay, so, but obviously by construction, CPA misses this multiple scattering effect that Anderson pointed out that can lead to the looping of electron within some region of space or localization of electron within some region of space. So of course, the obvious way or intuitive way to bring back these effects into the analysis was to do a cluster approximation. And this is what has been done by Mark and Krishnamurti in 2001. So DCA has been developed as a time for interacting system, and then they apply the similar approach, similar construction, because we can see this is very similar to the system with disorder. And the main summary, it's a very nice paper actually, very well written, and it shows it, but the main summary is this. The dynamical cluster approximation, DCA, is modified to include disorder. The DCA incorporates non-local corrections. You can capture this non-local scattering effect to local approximation such as CPA by mapping the lattice problem with disorder into the cluster. However, as shown in this paper, it cannot describe Anderson localization, and I'll show you how. So, now let's put pictures to what I just said in words. So going from CPA to DCA. So now instead of mapping the lattice into the impurity, we map the lattice into the cluster embedded in effective medium, right? Within DCA, DCA is a momentum space approximation. So instead of in CPA, there is no momentum dependence. In DCA, we bring back the momentum dependence, but only within the resolution of the cluster. Okay, so K capital is a cluster cluster momentum, and the larger is the cluster, the closer this capital K is to K. Okay, but in this approximation, put these diagrams here, we bring back some of this multi-impurity scattering effect, because these crosses correspond to different impurities. So we bring back some of the multiple scattering effects that have been completely washed out in CPA. But again, this is only done within the resolution of the cluster, okay? Now let's look at the results. So these results were basically, these results on the left were presented in the original paper. They look at density of states for the binary distribution, binary alloy. And they plot here, CPA is a black line and DCA is a red line. So we can see that within DCA, we restore some correlation-induced features in the density of states. So you see this finite structure in the density of states, which are coming from non-local correlations, are recovered in DCA, and they are completely averaged out in CPA picture. And we have some tails appearing in the spectrum. So and these are all non-local correlations effect, which has been averaged out completely in CPA. However, and here, these are our new results that we recently published in Annals of Physics. If we look at the average density of state at the bend center as function of disorder strength VA, for example, and we do this, basically we are asking at which disorder strength does this gap open in the spectrum, in the average spectrum. And we do this analysis for single site and for other cluster sizes. So what we see is that there is actually a strong dependence, non-strong dependence on the cluster at which disorder strength this gap opens, right? So here we show that for the binary alloy, for the average density of states, we find strong non-local effects near band splitting phase transition, right? When bands are split and you have a gap in the density of states. We see that NC equal to one happens at around 0.6 disorder, while a larger cluster is around 0.9, something like that. Okay, so strong NC dependent on the average density of states, but also this is the main result, basically the main result from the original paper. So after all, they hope to recover to capture the Anderson transition, because they brought the multiple scattering impurity effects into the analysis. And to demonstrate if there is a metal in Anderson localization or not, they use this return probability. So PT, which you see this is defined by the Green's function LL as function of time. So it measures the probability of finding electron at a given site L, and it's going to stay there with time, as function of time, right? So if electron is localized, this PT will be finite. And if electron is extended, it's going to be zero, okay? So this return probability has been plotted for different cluster sizes. These curves, this is a zoom in, are curves for different clusters, NC equal to one. And this is how you increase cluster size, you move in this direction. So we can see that for shorter times, we do see that as we increase cluster size, the return probability becomes finite and increases, right? However, as you run your calculation for a longer time, we see that return probability finally goes to zero as time increases. So as was put in the paper, the DCA actually captures some precursor of Anderson localization by having finite probability, return probability, but does not capture Anderson localization. Okay, now 10 years later, in 2014, I think we started this analysis, we introduced a typical medium DCA, it's the typical medium version of dynamical cluster approximation. And why typical medium theory? We have a wonderful lecture by Vlad Brusavljevic. This is a link to YouTube lecture. And but here I will, for completeness of the presentation, I will point out the main step and the main philosophy behind why do we need typical medium treatment of Anderson localization. So in CPA as well as in DCA, we calculate the self-consistent C-loop, right, is done in such a way that the quantity we calculate is a global arithmetically average density of states, right? And if we plot this average density of states, algebraic, arithmetical, algebraic average density of states at different values of disorder, at weak, moderate, and strong disorder, so what do we see? We see that density of states becomes wider and lower, right? And that's expected, right? Disorder brings a smearing of the bands and broadens the bands. However, as you look at the picture, the behavior is very smooth, right? There is no critical behavior in this data. So global, so the main message here is that average density of state is not an order parameter for to distinguish between these localized and extended states. Okay. Instead of looking at the global density of states, one should look at the local density of states. And this idea had been pointed out by Phil Anderson initially when he said, every atom is not an average atom, okay? So instead of looking at the global picture, one has to look at the local density of states in a given site. And here we see a huge difference. So here we plot local density of states as function of omega for weak disorder. And here a dashed line corresponds to the global average density of states, like this one that we calculate in CPADCA. And shaded regions corresponds to the local density of states. So we plot here for weak disorder and strong disorder. We can clearly see that there is a dramatic difference in the behavior of the local density of states for below the transition and the above the transition. Below the transition is a smooth function of frequency, while as you pass critical value of disorder and you get to insulator, local density of states becomes a spiky features and it has a set of, it looks like a set of delta function. So basically local density of states as we increase disorder changes qualitatively upon localization. It from in metal, it looks like a continuous function, while in insulator it looks like a discrete function as a set of delta function basically. So, this indicates that local density of state can be used actually as an order parameter for defining Anderson localization. And indeed, there have been several several attempts in the literature to point out that or proposal in the literature that in order to study Anderson localization, one problem is to look at the statistics of the local density of states. And here, and let me demonstrate that this is actually a proper way to do this. So if you look at probability distribution function of the local density of states, and we plot it for weak disorder, and we plot it for strong disorder. So for weak disorder, we have the probability distribution function looks like a Gaussian, and the peak of the Gaussian corresponds to the typical or most probable value and the average value shown here in blue, and we see that they coincide, right? So this is example of, so basically for weak disorder, we have self-averaging phenomena. However, as we go to the large disorder, we are entering the regime where we have non-self-averaging phenomena. In this case, the most probable value and the average value are different. Average value stays finite, like most probable, but most probable value is getting closer to zero. And we see that this is due to the fact that probability distribution function is no longer Gaussian. It has this like log normal distribution, has long tails, and this very strong skewness, right? So CPA and DCA are measuring this average value, which is finite, but typical medium series attempts to measure this most probable value, the one that you will actually measure in this disordered materials, right? And this is actually what is happening in the material. Okay, so main message here is that if you want to study Anderson localization and large disorder is not self-averaging phenomena, meaning that most probable and average are not the same. So one has to somehow find the way how to measure the most probable value instead of average value in order to sample the true behavior of the material. Okay, and these ideas have been implemented with an effective medium treatment by Vlado Brusavich. He has given us a wonderful lecture 2 weeks ago with all details, but in a quick review. So idea is very simple, to very similar to CPA and DMFT, to all these effective medium approaches. Lattice is mapped to the impurity embedded in effective medium, but now that medium is now not average, algebraically average, but it's typical medium. So instead of calculating algebraically average Green's function of the impurity, we calculate typical then Green's function. Okay, which is defined here. So typical density of states is approximate, in order to properly calculate typical, one would need to have a probability distribution function and get the the maximum point. So approximation here is that we use the geometric averaging as approximation to the typical value, and geometric average is calculated as exponent disorder average of log rho. Okay, and then once you have rho, you can do Hilbert transform to get the Green's function of the impurity. Okay, so this is a big point. Instead of algebraic averaging, you do geometric averaging over log of the density of states. Okay, so that's a different, but the rest self-consistency loop stays the same. And according to this idea, what we expect that for small disorder, typical density of states should be finite, right? Should be finite like here. And we would have extended state. But once we pass the critical disorder strength, typical density of state should go to zero because that will signal localized states. Okay, so this is self-consistency loop. The only change is only how you calculate the typical on the impurity level. The rest stays the same of the self-consistency loop. And this is a quick snapshot of the results that Vlad has gotten within typical medium theory. But this is our data for finite cluster for NC equal to one recovers TMT. So here we plot average density of states, algebraically average density of states by this shown by dashed lines, and typical density of state is shown by the shaded region. So at small disorder, we expect the typical, most probable, and the average should be the same because probability distribution function of the local density of state is Gaussian. We have self-averaging is satisfied. However, as we increase disorder, we observe that typical density of state gets narrower and lower, it shrinks. And as you increase disorder strength farther and farther, what we see is that typical density of states vanishes, goes to zero, but average density of state is fine, right? So this is all consistent with the idea that typical and the average value are being different due to non-self-averaging phenomena at large disorder. But let's see what we have accomplished with this. With this, we have shown that indeed, within effective medium treatment, typical density of state measured as a geometrical average over disorder, it can be indeed used as an order parameter to distinguish localized and extended states, because it is finite for extended states and it's zero for localized states. So yes, it can signal the transition. However, so that was a big breakthrough. However, by construction, it's only single-sided approximation. So of course, it has some limitation. In particular, the critical value of disorder at which transition happened in 3D Anderson model is 1.65. But we know the true value is 2.1. So it strongly underestimates the critical value of disorder. And also, it doesn't capture properly the proper behavior of the mobility edge boundaries that I will show you a little bit later, how it recovers is late. So that was done in 2003. Then 10 years later, Mark decided to revisit his DCA and incorporate typical medium treatment within DCA. Okay. And we have multiple people's efforts, and many papers have been published for that. But the summary of all findings of all application of TMDCA can be found in this review article shown here. Okay, so typical medium DCA. So we had several tries how we could do this, because you see this typical medium approach, it's ad hoc. It's not a well-defined approach to some extent, right? So one has to make a reasonable guess of how you calculate this typical density of states in the cluster. So this is the ansatz we constructed for the for the cluster DCA in the typical medium. So here we have geometrically averaged local density of states, which is separated from algebraically averaged non-local density of states, which carries a momentum k. Okay, so this ansatz has two limits. For nc equal to one, when cluster size is one, we should recover TMT, and we do, because this term cancels with this, and we have just only this exponent log rho term. So we recover single side TMT. And we also, for disorder much smaller than a critical disorder, basically in weak disorder limit, this term and this term cancel out, and we recover rho is equal rho average of rho k. So we recover DCA limit. Okay, so two limits are recovered. One can ask how good is the guess. So we compare the density of states, typical density of state calculated with this ansatz, and compare this with the kernel polynomial method analysis, which was done by Kamin-Tan. So here we show black line average density of states, typical density of state calculated with TMGCA shown in red, and typical geometrically average density of states calculated with kernel polynomial method are shown in blue dots. So we see that we have a quite good agreement between these two methods, so quite a good guess. Recently in our proceedings, we have also looked closer on the role of this geometrically averaged local piece and non-local piece. So here I plot average density of state black lines, and I plot typical density of states red dash area, and typical density of state calculated within this local ansatz, just this geometric piece, is shown by the dashed line here. So what we can see, what we are learning from this, is that in TMGCA, the main contribution, it does come from this local physics and geometrically average density of states, but the edges are, the non-local contribution is basically captured properly by the edges where you have some momentum dependence, okay? So we have done this for both distribution and for binary distribution. I'm going running out of time, so I'll just go to this slide. So one can use this approach and calculate typical density of states. I'm sorry, typical density of states at the band center, right, for different disorder strengths, because at the band center, this is the last point to get localized, and plot typical density of states at the band center as function of disorder strengths. And you can do, one can do this for different cluster size. So red is NC equal to one, which is TMT result, and other curves are for 8, 27, and 64 clusters. So what you can see, and in this way, by looking at the point when typical density of states goes to zero at the band center, this is the signal of the metal insulator transition. So below here we have metal, and here we have insulator, like for example for NC equals two, right? So you can see how the critical value of disorder at which transition happens changes with cluster size n. So what do we see? And this is plotted here. The critical increases with nc and then saturate, right? So we find a quick convergence of the cluster of the critical disorder strength with the cluster size, basically after nc equal to 8, 27 and 64 are basically on the top of each other. And we recover now critical value of disorder is much closer to the true value. So it's around 2.25 in DCA, TMDCA. Also, it's interesting to notice that this orange crosses, this corresponds to the end. That's when we have just local geometrically averaging term. So we see that the behavior at the band center is very well captured by this local physics. And this is, I think, what has been speculated in the literature, the close to the transition local physics dominates. So we have done this analysis also for binary disorder, where we look at the, when, the point when typical density state goes to zero, which signals the Anderson localization transition. And we find that for binary disorder, there is a weak, very weak cluster size dependence, but at the same time, there was a strong cluster size dependence for the average density of states, opening the average density of states shown here. Okay, so main message here is that going beyond single side approximation, we can recover the exact results. Or get closer to the exact results, we see that it is absolutely necessary to go beyond single side approximation, and non-local correlation and a local effect are strong in this regime. Okay, and here I want to show one more graph. Here we show, this is disorder versus energy phase diagram. And this is obtained with, so these colors here, they basically model the mobility edge trajectory, right? So mobility edge separates local extendants from localized states. So here we would have extended states and here we would have localized states. And it is shown for NC equal to one and different colors corresponds to different cluster sizes. And one of them of the color is in green, it's hard to see, dark green is transfer metric method. So it's exact. So we can see that increasing cluster size going from NC equal to one, which strongly underestimates the mobility edge behavior, we can gradually converge to the exact solution for the mobility edge trajectory. Okay, and I just want to emphasize that this is all captured by this beyond single site approximation. So these are all non-local effects which needs to be taken into account into in the theory. We have the extended applies this typical method in very different systems. We look at disorder plus interactions. And we have a lecture by Lott, how disorder effect and how interaction and disorder affect each other in Anderson-Hubbard model. So we see that once we have interaction U, the value, critical value of disorder at which transition to Anderson insulate happens increases due to the screening effect. Then we applied this method to the off-diagonal disorder system where you not only change the local potential, but also change the way electron can hop from AA to ABB and AB atoms. And this is a phase diagram. Basically the main message here, dashed lines are NC equal to one. So the main message here is that one definitely needs to go beyond single site approximation in order to capture non-local effects in this off-diagonal disorder picture because NC equal to one does a very poor job in this regime. We have also applied this to multi-band systems where we demonstrated that indeed for some parameter regime, one has to take into account local effects in order to capture the properly the value of disorder at which when metal insulated transition happens. Okay, so recently it has been also extended to real materials. This was basically driven by Yi Zhang and Tom Berlin collaboration with Envy Kuo. And there we studied how we use the density functional theory was ran fast, then they would give us effective Hamiltonian and that effective Hamiltonian we would plug it in the TMDCA analysis to calculate typical density of states. This has been applied to iron-based superconductors as well as intermediate band semiconductors. For iron-based superconductors, we found the typical density of state is not zero. So these materials are not Anderson localized. However, for intermediate band semiconductors, interesting physics come here when system electrons are localized in the impurity band, because then you can have different photovoltaic response. And it was found that this impurity band is indeed a localized, so typical density of states goes to zero at some concentration, I think here less than 2%. And it found to be in agreement with experiments. And these efforts have recently evolved into even larger collaboration, which is a part of this presentation, MAST collaboration, where we want to study electron localization disorder effect within the multiple scattering theory. And we have two, and also we have collaboration with Livuchian, Seldita, Wolhardt, where we try to embed this, where we try to do self-consistent treatment of typical medium theory analysis in ab initio level, as well as incorporating interaction and disorder in real material picture with a typical medium effects. So this is my final slide summary. So today I showed you that quantum cluster theory, in particular DCA, can be used to start study interesting effect and in particular localization of electron in disorder and strongly interacting systems. They are powerful techniques. They can capture strong interaction and localization effects properly, as well as non-local effects, which I have shown you today, which can be significant in near the metal insulated transition. So cluster theory can capture these non-local effects properly. And I have shown you that dynamical cluster approximation can be used to study metal insulated transition into D-Hubbard model. Non-local effects are very strong. Typical medium DCA can be used to study Anderson localization. One going beyond single-sided approximation is also very important. So these methods are computationally feasible to study complex systems, including because they are Green function methods, so one can study interacting, non-interacting, and also interacting and disordered systems. So if you want to hear more and watch other videos along this direction, please visit our MAST YouTube channel and our GitHub repository. And also this is a review of the TMBS DCA if you want to learn more details. Okay, so this is the end of my presentation. And if you have any questions.
Yeah, thank you, Hannah. It's a great talk, very nice.
Thank you so much.
So should I stop recording and we start ask questions or you want to?
Yes, let's do that. I need to drink some water.
Okay, let me stop recording, then we can just chat. Mm-hmm. Thank you.